Hi, good morning and welcome to the Ladaflow version 2.3 release webinar, and thank you for accepting the invitation to join this event. My name is Mike Branchflower. I'm the Global Sales Manager for Ladaflow in Kongsberg. If you're having any difficulties with audio, please go to the audio pane and click on the sound check, which is in blue, and that will guide you through the process of setting it up. You can also join over the telephone if you can't get the audio to work. You'll have the opportunity to submit questions. What you can do is type questions into the questions pane on the right-hand side near the bottom. You can send them in at any time during the presentation and demonstration, and what we'll do is answer as many as we can at the end, and those that we can't answer, we'll email you personally afterwards. There's also a Ladaflow product sheet near the bottom in the handout section that you're welcome to download as well. I'm now going to hand over to Wouter Dijkhuizen. He is the Ladaflow product champion, and he will present and demonstrate the new functionality associated with the release of version 2.3.
I hope you can see my screen now. Is it working, Mike?
Yes, all good, Wouter.
Yep, good. Thanks for the introduction, Mike. So this presentation will be about some of the new features in Ladaflow 2.3. So I have a very short presentation for starters, just to introduce a couple of things, and then after that we will do some demos and show you what the software looks like. So the contents of this short presentation is so we've worked a lot on the inline separator in this release. We have done a lot of improvements on the wax deposition model that we will go through. There are some other notable model improvements, and there are a couple of things in the GUI I would like to show as well, like the device boundary chart, and the parametric studies have been improved as well. And then we'll close it off with demos, and after that some questions. So the inline separator. So what we've done in version 2.3 of Ladaflow is to extend the end of line separator model. So previously it was only possible to have a separator tank at the end of a pipeline without any pipes connected to it. So what we've done now is allow adding pipes to the outlets of the separator so that you can simulate mainly subsea separation. But we've made this completely general, so it's possible to also do other scenarios like two-stage separation. I will show that during the demonstration as well. And many other scenarios that we haven't even thought about. So it's completely flexible. You can have one pipe, two pipes, three pipes for a three-phase separator connected to it. But it's not, you can choose the pipes that you want to simulate. So for instance, you could just look at what happens to the liquid coming out of your separator in terms of boosting. And then, after you're satisfied with that, then you can add a pipe to the gas outlet later on. So it can sort of evolve during the field life or during the study that you're doing. So it's very flexible. So the solution that we have for the inline separator, it's still the same as for the end-of-line separator, meaning that we support any kind of PVT. So you can use PVT tables that you use from Olga. You can use black oil PVT, which is useful for well modeling. And it's also possible to run fully compositionally with multi-flash. So the only PVT that we don't support are single components like CO2 and steam, but I'm not really convinced that it's very useful to look at separators for those kind of systems. Some other improvements have been made as well to the separator. So we now support different shapes of heads. So previously we only had flat heads, which are it's not really regular to have those in industry. So now we support elliptical and other head shapes so that you can simulate a realistic separator tank. And also, finally, we've improved the GUI design a bit, so it's much easier now to set up the separator. So there's still a lot of input parameters, but we've organized it a bit more logically, and also adding the pipes to the separator on the outlets. That has been made very user-friendly. Okay, that is the inline separator. So the second main feature in this release are the wax deposition improvements. So the wax deposition model has been released in Ladaflow version 2.0. And then, yeah, after a while, we got a lot of feedback from customers about things that we should consider improving. So that's what we've done now in version 2.3. So the first thing we've improved is the interpolation of the precipitation curve. So the precipitation curve, it's a user input that typically comes from your PVT package. But in the version 2.0 until now, we've used linear interpolation. So as you can see on the right here, so if you linearly interpolate this precipitation curve, it's not going to be so accurate if you have only a few points. And it's actually very common to have low resolution on this precipitation curve. So there are typically not that many points. And then it turned out that this gave some, it wasn't very good for the accuracy of the wax precipitation. So I will show that with an example during the demonstration afterwards as well, to make it a bit more easy to understand what the effect is. But this greatly improves the accuracy now that we have a smooth interpolation function. And also it means that the wax layer thickness profile will be smooth. Earlier there were some strange bumps in that profile. So that has actually helped a lot. Then there were some issues with the pressure drop increase due to the wax deposit. So when a wax deposits on the inside of the pipe, the surface area or diameter of the pipe, it effectively gets reduced. And this leads to higher back pressure or higher pressure drop through the pipe. And then this, the model that we used for that, it was not working properly before, and this has been fixed. So you will get a pressure drop increase now because of the wax deposit forming in the pipe. The third thing that we improved is related to non-Newtonian wax slurry rheology. We got a lot of feedback from some of you and also other customers that we should really consider implementing the Pedersen non-Newtonian wax slurry model, which is used a lot in PVT sim to characterize wax slurries. So that's what we've did. So now if you look at the wax deposition settings, which is where you enter the input data for the model, you can see that it's possible to choose the viscosity model. And then you can enter the D, E, and F parameters, which are coming from PVT sim. Basically, these are tuning coefficients. If you run with a value of 1, then you're running with the default parameters that the Pedersen model has. So you would expect these parameters to be somewhere in the order of 1, even for other fluids. Then we've also added the option of increasing the wall roughness when there's a wax deposit. So depending on how the wax deposit forms on your on your pipe wall and what kind of wax it is, it could either be a rough or a smooth deposit. So we've made it a advanced option where you can tune the wall roughness when the wax deposit forms. So this option is turned off by default because we're not certain that for every possible case, it's really physically correct to have a wall roughness increase. But if you need this for a study, then it's possible to put in a factor here, which is greater than 0. And what this does is that if you have, let's say you put in a factor of 1 over here, then 1 millimeter of wax deposit, it will give you 1 millimeter of wall roughness. So that way, if you have a few millimeters of wax deposit, it increases the wall roughness quite a lot. And you can change the dependency by changing the factor here. And then finally, so after forming a wax deposit, so it was already possible in Ladaflow to remove the wax deposit again by flushing with hot water or dead oil or something like that. But we also have another method now to remove the wax deposit, which is by pigging. So it's possible to send a pig through the pipe and then the wax deposit will be completely removed. But what we've assumed here is that the removed wax is it's not tracked in the simulation because we don't really have a model to account for the viscosity of large chunks of wax in the oil phase anyway. So we didn't track the wax removal, but at least you can use pigging to clear a pipeline of wax now. Okay, that concludes the wax deposition improvements. So we also have some other notable model improvements. So for the related to hydrate inhibitors and also custom fluids, we've done something with the viscosity mixing rule, which is what it basically changes the water viscosity if you put glycol, methanol, and ethanol in the water phase. So the previous mixing rule did not adjust for non-ideality, so it was basically a standard mixing rule. But because of the polar groups in these molecules, it's very non-ideal. So we've added an additional parameter that can be adjusted as well. But we're providing some default values that are suitable for these hydrate inhibitors. And this corrects a problem where one of the customers complained that if you have a very concentrated MAG, so typically let's say 50% or higher, then the viscosity of the water phase was quite a lot too high. So this has been corrected, and we've tested all of these hydrate inhibitors against the prediction of multi-flash. So if you're using custom fluids now, all of the viscosities will be correct. Then we've also added salt as a custom fluid. So the reason for adding salt is that it's a very powerful hydrate inhibitor. And then we would like to model the effect of that it has on the hydrate margins along the pipe. And then the thing with salt is it's not really suitable of putting it in your PVT table because the concentration of salt along the pipeline, it can change very easily. For instance, when water condensates from the gas phase, or if water evaporates from the water phase. So along the pipeline, it's very common for the salt concentration to change. And then because this salt is such a powerful hydrate inhibitor, we need to take into account the change in concentration along the pipe that it has on the hydrate margin. So it's now possible to model this salt as a custom fluid instead of putting it in a PVT table. Then finally, we've extended the Hammersmith equation, which is used for hydrate margin calculation. Instead of only handling one single inhibitor that you have to select as a user, it's now possible to handle any mixture of inhibitors. So for instance, it's possible to have both salt as well as glycol in the water phase. And then Ladaflow calculates the combined hydrate margin effect of both of these inhibitors, which is very useful because the small amount of salt that comes from your produced fluids, it helps a lot to reduce the hydrate risk. Also, a side effect of this is now it's no longer necessary to select a specific inhibitor if you use the Hammersmith equation in Ladaflow. So it's it automatically takes into account all of the hydrate inhibitors that are in the flow. Okay, and then the last model improvement I would like to mention is that for choke valves, where you have a lot of pressure drop across the valve, we are now flashing across the valve because the normal mass transfer model in Ladaflow, which is based on kinetics, it is a bit too slow for this specific case. So that's why we're using a pH flash to quickly achieve mass transfer equilibrium across a choke valve. So basically, we are assuming that the fluid is fully mixed in the valve body and that mass transfer happens instantaneously, which I think is physically reasonable. Okay, so those were all the model changes in Ladaflow 2.3. So then now something a little bit lighter, which is about the GUI changes. So we now have a new module in the GUI, which is called Device Boundary Chart. So here we show time-varying model inputs. And then we've limited to a couple of inputs, like the flow rates, temperature, pressure, valve opening fraction, and leak diameter. And then the reason for having this feature is that it makes it easier to set up dynamic cases, like for instance a shut-in or a depressurization. So as an example here, I've made a case with two wells, and they have both a gas lift and inflow from the reservoir. There's a leak here on the main flow line. And you can see here that after 1,000 seconds the leak opens, and then afterwards you can see that the valves close. These are the two wellhead chokes, and then the gas lift stops as well after about an hour. And then over here we have a depressurization. So by putting this together with as a stack of different plots, it makes it possible to see if the simulation is set up correctly. So it's very useful to make sure that the timing of closing the valves and closing the sources, etc., to make sure that it's set up in a correct order, and that there's nothing wrong with the simulation before you run it. So I recommend you to check it out. It's very nice. I've also made some improvements to the parametric study module. So the main focus was on making it easier to select input parameters. So now this dialog where you select the input parameters, it has been redesigned a bit. So it's much easier to find what you're looking for. So all the sources and pressure boundaries, etc., they're all gathered, and it's dynamic. So you're only seeing what you have in your selected case. And then selecting the actual property has also become much easier. We're showing the base case value over here, so it's easier to see what you're actually doing. And also the table has been improved a bit, also to make it more user-friendly. So the rows have been made a bit smaller, so it doesn't take up as much space. And now the column header, it is spread over multiple lines. So in this case, it's much easier to see because of that. That's okay. You have a certain pipe that we're looking at. We're looking at the trend of that. We're looking at the pressure drop property, and then the total pressure drop as opposed to the gravitational or frictional pressure drop. So this makes it easier to see what is actually here. Yeah, and we also fixed a couple of things, like if your computer was very busy, sometimes it was possible for these results over here not to be calculated properly. And we've tested all the possible input parameters, and then any kind of issues related to that were also resolved. Okay, then we get to the demo part. So what I would like to show you are we have some new sample cases in LadaFlow. And we've improved the existing sample cases as well. Then I would like to show the inline separator, and then finally the wax deposition model. Okay, I think we're doing okay on time, yes. So first of all, the sample cases in LadaFlow. So if you add a case in LadaFlow by right-clicking somewhere in the case browser and selecting new case, then you have this tab over here which has sample cases. So we've improved this actually. So now if you look at this, previously there was some not so interesting information here, but now we've changed this to include keywords. And this makes it possible to find, for instance, a multi-phase pump here, or a case with CO2. And then some of the cases, they simulate different things. So you can see that, okay, this case, it does multiple things. And then and that way it's easier to find a sample case that is relevant to what you're interested in. And then, for instance, if I take this one, then it creates one of the sample cases. You can see that it opens the nodes tab over here in the status window. We've included a description now with every single sample case, which explains how to run this and what the meaning of this case is and what to do with it. So that's very useful. And also the parametric studies that are attached to this particular case, they all have their own description over here. So you can see how to do line sizing with erosion risk over here. You can look at gas lift optimization. So it's very nice to, if you're new to Ladaflow, to look at some of these sample cases to see what, how you do things in Ladaflow. Okay, so the next thing I would like to show you is the inline separator. So, by the way, if you want to look at this particular sample case, this is actually one of the sample cases for the inline separator, so you can replicate it afterwards. So it says subsea separator sample case here. And so this is just to show you what it looks like for a separator. So one of the things we've added now is there's an outlet connection option if you right click on the separator. So this is where you can set up the connections to the outlet pipe, so you can connect and disconnect the different outlets of the separator to other pipes. So it's not necessary to set up a separator with the correct connections in advance. So you can do this along the way after you build a model. So it's very useful. You can easily correct any mistakes or expand your model afterwards. Then this is the GUI of the separator. So this has been reorganized a bit, so it's a bit easier to find different things. So here you set up the geometry. These are the different head sizes that I talked about. So you can have bumped heads, elliptical heads, according to different definitions like ASME or DIN. So all of that is in there. Heat transfer, it's basically as before. Yeah, inlet loss, it's not so interesting. And then over here we have the outlets for the separators, which is also similar to before. And then it has just been reorganized a bit. Yep. So this case I've already run in advance. So this sample case, basically what it, I'll just minimize this for a bit. So basically what it demonstrates is how to start up a subsea separator. So this is a this is a multi-phase pipe which is relatively short, so it's coming from a wellhead. Then it goes, the multi-phase flow goes in the separator, and then we separate just the liquid and the gas. So this is a two-phase separator. And then we use a pump to transport the liquid topside. So you can see this is a very long pipeline, about 30 kilometers, with a 1,000 meter riser at the end. And then the gas pipe is the same. And then, so the whole idea behind this case is just to transport the gas and liquid separately to avoid multi-phase flow as much as possible. And not in the least, it makes the boosting a lot cheaper because you don't need an expensive pump to handle all this gas here. So if you look at some of the plots that we generate, so this is the plot of the pump. So we can see that in the beginning, if you look at the volume flow rate, so it's there is some fluid going through here in the start, but the pump is still ramping up. So if you look at the speed of the pump, initially it is at zero. Then during two hours we ramp up the pump speed, and then we can see that the pressure boost it increases when we ramp up the pump, and until at the end we get about 40 bar boost. And then it varies a little bit because we're using pump curves over here, so it's a function of the gas fraction at the inlet and flow rate, etc. So this pressure boost, it moves around a bit. Then one of the other plots, so this is what happens in the liquid pipe. So initially there's there's quite a lot of gas actually, and then when we move it around a bit, so here is where we start up the liquid pipe, and then the gas is replaced by liquid. And we can see that there's only a little bit of gas remaining in the pipe afterwards. So I think we're quite successful in transporting mostly liquid, which makes the pumping process a lot cheaper. Then let's see what this last plot is. So this is looking at the internals of the separator. So we have the separator pressure over here, so it's at 70 bar. There's a couple of disturbances here because I didn't really tune the separator to the best possible performance. I was quite pleased with it already. You can see the interface height here, so it's working well. There's no sign of the separator flooding or anything. And also the oil water level is very low here. That's just because this is a two-phase separator, so we don't care about this property really. I can also remove it. Then we can see that well, the inflow matches the outflow, so the separator has reached a steady state. So for instance, the gas coming in and the gas coming out, they're the same basically. So this separator is totally running in steady state mode. Yes, just to show for the separator that it's also possible to make a cascade of separators. So you can have a high pressure and a low pressure separator feeding into a high pressure gas network and a low pressure gas network, and then a liquid pipe for all the liquid passing through both separators. So it's possible to do a lot of different cases now that you can connect pipes to the separator. Yeah, then I would like to say something about the interpolation related to the wax deposition model. I was first, let me just introduce you to the problem here first. So if you go to the wax deposition settings, so we have this precipitation curve here, and on purpose I've created a precipitation curve that is very crude, so it only has 4 points here. So normally this would be, I think we would have a little bit better resolution, but this is just to show you what effect the interpolation has, whether you do this with linear interpolation or using a spline. So I've run the case in 2.2 and 2.3, so they're both the same case using the Newtonian viscosity model. And then if you compare the results, it's quite shocking to see the difference actually. So in 2.2 with linear interpolation, you can see that the wax deposition profile, so this is the thickness of the wax layer, there's a strange bump here, and then there's another bump over here, and then another one over there. And that is related to the interpolation of the precipitation curve. You can also see it in the wax volume fraction. You can see it goes here and then up like this and then up like that. So this is an imprint of the linear interpolation basically. So that's not physical. In reality, this precipitation curve is supposed to be smooth. But now in version 2.3, you can see that there's a bit of a delay because of the, we've now smoothed out this curve. So it takes a while longer for the wax to start forming. And then the wax layer thickness profile, it's approximately smooth. So there's a little bit of a small bump here and there, but that's just because this deposition model, it has a lot of model inputs, not just the precipitation curve. So there are also other effects on which cause these small ripples. But all in all, it's much smoother now. You can also see that here in the wax volume fraction. So that when the wax formation when it kicks off, you can see it's totally smooth along the entire pipe, which means that we succeeded in making this work properly now. So that's quite interesting. So there's both a delay in where the wax forms basically, plus the it's much smoother now, the wax precipitation. Also, I can mention that the amount of wax formed in this case, it doesn't matter, but we've seen cases where suddenly there's a lot less wax formation. So it can have an effect on the total amount of wax as well. Okay, then the last thing I would like to demonstrate is the Pedersen viscosity model for the wax slurry. So just to show you where this is, so you can select a viscosity model now in the wax deposition settings. So it's either the existing or the old Thomas model, which is Newtonian, or the Pedersen model, which is non-Newtonian. There's also a tooltip here to help you a little bit with that. And then for the Pedersen model, the inputs, they are the DEF parameters that you get from PVT-SIM. Yeah, so I've just run the standard case that we use with the flow line and the riser, just comparing the Thomas viscosity model against the Pedersen viscosity model. And both of these models, they run with the default parameters, so I haven't changed anything. So then if we compare the two, So the Pedersen model, that is the red curve with the dots, and then the green curve, that is the Newtonian Thomas model. You can see that the wax thickness profile, it is there's very little difference. There's maybe 10 maximum 20% difference in the wax thickness, so it's the influence of the viscosity model is relatively small. You can also see that the reason why there's not that much difference is because the viscosity of the oil is not very different, and then that is actually a result of the custom fluid fraction of the wax. So in this case, there's only a maximum amount of 1.5 percent volume of wax in the oil phase. So then it's just not a very waxy test case. So you can see this will be, I think the difference will be much more pronounced if you have more wax in the oil. But in general, I would say this non-Newtonian effect, it's much stronger if you start looking at dynamic cases like shutdown, restart, etc. Okay, that concludes the presentation and demonstration. So I'll hand it back to Mike for the questions. Are you there, Mike?
Sorry, everyone, I was still muted on a different device. Thank you very much, Wouter. We're going to answer some questions that have been submitted during the presentation. We have two questions from Alec Jameson from Genesis Oil and Gas in London. First question to you, Wouter, is the mass of wax ahead of a pig conserved in the simulations?
So it's that's a tricky question. So it's basically the wax that we remove from the pipe wall using the pigging. It's not tracked at all. So it's kind of irrelevant. We don't track it. So we're really not conserving it.
Okay. Yeah.
Then the reason why we don't track it is because we don't really have a good reason for tracking it. Because if I imagine a pig scraping off wax chunks of wax from the pipe wall, I don't think it will turn into a wax slurry with small wax particles. It will probably be big chunks of wax that are pushed forward. So it's we don't really have a suitable viscosity model for it anyway.
Yeah. Okay. The last question that we've got, we had two questions, another one from Alec. Why in the separator GUI does the gas dashed line connect downstream with the flow boundary? Where's the real connection? I'm not sure if this is something we can answer in the webinar or take separately, but...
No, that's okay. So the reason why we have this dotted line is because we're using the same concept for connecting the separator to the pipes. We're using the same concept as a leak. So that's why we have this dotted line, and it's not connecting to the flow boundary, but it's connecting to the actual pipe. And then there's also another advantage in the future. If you want to connect it not to the first cell but to another part of the pipeline, then we can actually change it. So right now you cannot connect it to anything other than the first cell of the pipe, but we might change that in the future, because at least we have a way of changing it.
Okay, very good. Those were the only questions that we had posted. So if you do have any other questions, please feel free to drop me an email and we'll get back to you personally. Thank you again, Wouter, for a good presentation and demonstration, and thanks to everyone for attending the webinar. You should receive an email from us within a day with a link to view the video. We've tried to record it and automatically send you the video, so hopefully you'll receive that. Bear in mind, I think this is the first webinar we've ever done for Laderflow. I've said already, if you do have any questions, please just send me an email. We will get back to you. On behalf of Kongsberg, thank you for joining the webinar. We will be doing some more webinars around Laderflow, so we will be contacting you about those in the future, and hopefully you can join. And that's it, really. So hang on, someone's put their hand up quickly. What's that say before we go? can't see another question. No. Okay, that's gone now anyway. Okay, apologies for that. So we'll just leave it at that. Enjoy the rest of your day, and hope to see you again soon. Goodbye.